now stands the case, we have to educate a people who cannot at present be educated by means of their mother tongue. We must teach them some foreign language. The claims of our own language it is hardly necessary to recapitulate. It stands preeminent even among the languages of the West. It abounds with works of imagination not inferior to the noblest which Greece has bequeathed to us, with models of species of eloquence, with historical compositions which, considered merely as narratives, have seldom been surpassed, and which, considered as vehicles of ethical and political instruction, have never been equalled, with just and lively representations of human life and human nature, with the most profound speculations on metaphysics, morals, government, jurisprudence, and trade, with full and correct information respecting every experimental science which tends to preserve the health, to increase the comfort, or to expand the intellect of men. Whoever knows that language has ready access to all the vast intellectual wealth which all the wisest nations of the earth have created and hoarded in the course of 90 generations. It may safely be said that literature now extant in that language is of far greater value than all the literature which 300 years ago was extant in all the languages of the world together. Nor is this all. In India, English is a language spoken by the ruling class. It is spoken by the higher class of natives at the seats of government. It is likely to become the language of commerce throughout the seas of the East. It is the language of two great European communities which are rising, the one in the south of Africa, the other in Australasia. Communities which are every year becoming more important and more closely connected with our Indian Empire. Whether we look at the intrinsic value of our literature or at the particular situation of this country, we shall see the strongest reason to think that, of all foreign tongues, the English tongue is that which would be of most useful to our native subjects. The question now before us is simply whether it is in our power to teach this language. We shall teach languages in which, by universal confession, there are no books on any subject which deserve to be compared to our own. Whether we can teach European science, we shall teach systems which, by universal confession, whenever they differ from those of Europe, differ for the worse. And whether, when we can patronize sound philosophy and true history, we shall countenance at the public expense medical doctrines which would disgrace an English farrier, astronomy which would move laughter at the girls of an English building school, history abounding with kings 30 feet high and reigns 30,000 years long, and geography made up of seas of treacle and seas of butter. We are not without experience to guide us. History furnishes several analogous cases, and they all teach the same lesson. There are in modern times, to go no further, two memorable instances of great impulse given to the mind of a whole society, of prejudice overthrown, of knowledge diffused, of taste purified, of arts and sciences planted in countries which had recently been both ignorant and barbarous. The first instance to which I refer is the great revival of letters among the Western nations at the close of the 15th and the beginning of the 16th century. At that time, almost everything that was worth reading was contained in the writings of the ancient Greeks and Romans. Had our ancestors acted as the Committee of Public Instruction has hitherto acted, had they neglected the language of Cicero and Tacitus, had they confined their attention to the old dialects of their own islands, had they printed nothing and taught nothing at the universities but chronicles in Anglo-Saxon and romances in Norman French, would England have been what she now is? What the Greek and Latin were to the contemporaries of Moore and Isham is our tongue to the people of India. The literature of England is now more valuable than that of classical antiquity. I doubt whether the Sanskrit literature be as valuable as that of our Saxon northern progenitors. In some departments in history, for example, I am certain that it is much less so. Another instance may be said to be still before our eyes. Within the last 120 years, a nation which has previously been in a state as barbarous as that in which our ancestors were before the Crusades has gradually emerged from the ignorance in which it has sunk and has taken its place among civilized communities. I speak of Russia. There is now in that country a large educated class, abounding with persons fit to serve the state in the highest functions, and in no wise inferior to the most accomplished men who adorn the best circles of Paris and London. There is reason to hope this vast empire, which in the time of our grandfathers was probably behind the Punjab, may, in time of our grandchildren, be pressing close on France and Britain in the career of improvement. And how was this change effected? Not by flattering national prejudices, not by feeding the mind of the young Muscovite with the old woman's stories which his rude fathers had believed, not by filling his head with lying legends about St. Nicholas, nor by encouraging him to study the great question whether the world was or was not created on 13th of September, not by calling him a learned native when he had mastered all these points of knowledge, but by teaching him those foreign languages in which the greatest mass of information had been laid up, and thus putting all that information within his reach. The languages of Western Europe, civilized Russia, I cannot doubt that they will do for the Hindu what they have done for the Tatar.